Hi everyone, welcome to GIT series. So what we are trying to learn in here is the basic introduction of the version control systems, some history of those, some drawbacks and some plus and minuses, and then followed by how to work with Git and some theoretical concepts of Git in the series 1, and then in the part 2 we'll be going through how to implement them practically. So first of all, let's see some introduction on version control systems. So initially, version control systems can be divided into three models, like local data models. It's very initial part where everything used to be stored in Unix and users are parallelly logged in for working in the Linux model. So in this model, there are a lot of disadvantages. So that's the reason we have compared at the next level into centralized version control systems, where we can have everything, every resource stored centrally. So when we are working parallelly at different remote locations, we need to have the internet connection completely. Whenever we lose the internet connection, we will not be able to work on any changes. So if you wanted to work on a project, we need to have the internet connection at every point of time. Whenever an internet connection is lost or the version control system is down, we will not be able to work with our work. We will not be able to continue with our work. So this is the drawback of the centralized version control system. Since we will not be having a remote copy, local copy of the project, we need to depend upon the centralized system at every point of time. And whenever some network issue or the version control system goes down, we'll not be able to continue with our work and it spoils our work. So this is the problem with the centralized version control system. So we have come to distributed version control system. But in distributed version control system, we have all our data stored in the remote repository, and we can, while we wanted to work, start work, we will be taking a local copy of the remote repository from the remote repository to our local system. By maintaining a local repository in our system, we will be taking a backup copy from the remote repository and maintaining it in our local system. So once we have done some changes or modifications, we'll post that back to the remote repository. So this way we have everything accessible, even though when our internet connection goes down or when we are not able to connect to the version control system, there is absolutely no issues because we will be able to work with the copy that is available in our local repository. So this overcomes the drawback of the centralized version control system. So one of the distributed version control system which we are going to work with is Git. So let's see what's the difference. So we can see in here from the pic that you can see like the centralized version control system, say like a GitHub or a GitLab, and the local local repository that we maintain is a Git, and then we will be working with those files in our working directory using Eclipse IDE or etc. for making the changes to the local repository. And you can see various commands which we can initiate over here. So while we wanted to fetch the data existing project from centralized repository to our local repository for the first time, we'll be using the clone function. So we'll be able to clone that project from the centralized repository and store it in our local repository using the clone. So once we initiate the Git clone with the tab path, so what happens is like the project which we wanted to clone will be stored as a local copy in our local repository. Okay, you can see like when we are working in parallel, assume like a collaborator 1 is like a developer 1 is in one location, developer 2 is in different location, developer 3 is in different location, but they will be able to access and work very easily while maintaining, while we having a distributed version control system without any issues. So once we got, once we cloned the project from the centralized repository to the local repository, then we can access through using our Eclipse IDE by importing the project into our Eclipse IDE, and then what we can do is like we can modify or we can do some changes in the project, and then we can add the changes from our working directory, which is like an unstaged environment, to the staged environment using git commands like git add. And once these changes which have been modified have been staged, that means it have been tracked using an index. So once it has been tracked, what we can do is like from staging environment we can move it into our local repository. So we have three environments here. One is a working directory, local working directory, where we are going to make changes and all the things. And second is the staging environment to track the changes that we are making. And it's like a middle one where we wanted to push the changes. We wanted to have the changes being tracked, and then once it has been tracked, we wanted to look over it, and then whatever the changes we wanted to commit to the local repository, we will be able to commit it. So we'll use the git commit option to make the changes with the commit message, to commit the changes from the staging environment to the local repository. Once the changes have been committed from the working directory to the staging environment, and from staging environment to our local repository, then we can push our code to the centralized repository so that someone can utilize those code and start working from there. So this is very much introduction to distributed version control system, Git, and let's see the workflow. So what we are going to do is like in practical we are going to create a local repository, and then we'll be pushing our local project into the GitLab or GitHub, and then we'll start doing some modifications and then committing the changes and then doing branching and merging, rebasing, and then pulling the changes, pushing the changes, pitching, running an existing project. And then we'll try to understand what are the git icons that will be available in the Eclipse, like question marks and cylindrical icon, etc., etc. So one concept we wanted to go in and to have some introduction is like branching. What exactly is branching here? So when we are doing parallel collaboration, like people from different remote locations working with the different users to research in, developer 1 is working with user story 1, and developer 2 is working with user story 2, and some other developers are working with some other user stories. So they wanted to work in parallel. What they will be doing is like they will not be directly working on the master branch, but instead they will be creating a separate branch based on the user story, and then they will be working with their changes. Once the changes have been tested and it works fine, then they will be merging back into the master branch. So merging and rebiasing is a similar kind, but rebiasing is a bit different concept of merging. And then let's see some introduction, like how basically the commands are being distributed in Git. So Git users are basically classified into four types, like individual developer, standalone, individual developer who is a participant, and an integrator who will be making the commit, who will be pushing the changes, who will be fetching the changes from the central repository to local repository. He plays the role of an integrator and repository administrator, like who restricts the user access from doing certain things, like our system admins. So this is how basically the commands in Git have been distributed. It was distributed to individual developers, standalone, and individual developer as a participant, as an integrator, as a remote repository administrator. And as we had already spoken about the Git workflow, it is a automatic representation of the same thing. So what we are doing is like we are pulling the changes from the remote repository to our local repository, and then we are checking out we change this to a working folder. Once we have made some changes, then we'll be adding the changes for tracking purpose using the git command, git add. Once we do git add, it adds the index for to track the changes for the particular file, and then it moves into staging area. From staging area, whatever we wanted to commit to the local repository, we use a git commit followed by the message which we wanted to have it for the commit. Like example, if you're fixing a bug, so in the commit message we will be adding the bug ID so that it will be easy to track. So git commit is a command which is used for making the untracked changes, track changes to be moved to the local repository. And once this is done, we want to push the changes from our local repository to the central repository with this push command. So this is a very much simplified diagram of the same. We are adding from the workspace, our Eclipse ID where we are working on, which is my workspace location where we'll be working with the changes for the project. So from workspace, when we say the git add, it will be adding an index to our file representing that this is being tracked for the changes. Whatever changes you will make, it will be tracked based on the index. So it will be moving, the file will be moved into the staging area once you add. And then once you commit, it will be moving to the repository, that is a local repository in our local work machine. And then from our local work machine, we can push the code changes to our remote repository. And if you wanted to get back all the changes done by different collaborators, you can get through using the fetch or a clone command. So what is the basic difference between pull and fetch? So what happens is, like, if we are doing a pull, git pull, it directly pulls out all the changes from remote repository to the workspace. If we do a fetch, it will be fetching all the changes from the remote repository to our local repository, not directly to the workspace. So once we have fetched the changes to our local repository, then we need to again do the checkout, git checkout command, so that all the changes from the local repository will be checked out to the workspace. So it is a bit deeper for understanding everything in clear. So as I do, in the working copy, if we add the git add command, we add some files using the git add command. So what happens is, like, it will be adding an index. So these index are used for tracking the changes. So every change will be tracked using an index for the file. So if you wanted to reset the changes, what is the command that we use? Like git reset, hard reset, or soft reset. And then if you wanted to, there is one more way of resetting, like we can use the git checkout to reset the original file before committing. And then in the local repository itself, we have two different branches, kind of branches, local and remote branches. So what are the local branches? Like, if you are dealing with the local branches that are used for collaboration between the local repository and the working copy. So if it's the remote branches, what they are useful for collaborating between or establishing between our local repository to the remote repository. Unlike the local branches, which establishes the connection between the working copy and the local repository. And then as we had already done, git fetch is used for fetching the changes are downloading the project from remote repository to our local repository. So let's see, at each and every area, what are the commands that are available? When you're creating a repository, it's git init. Git init is used to initialize a new repository with an empty file. And then when we are trying to make changes, what are the commands available? I would like status, add, and commit. Once we use the git add and git commit, and once we go for status, it shows like the changes have been tracked, changes are committed. If we do, it is useful for tracking whatever the changes that were there, that were made. It was in which environment it was there, it was committed, or whether it was not committed, the particular file, it was in untracked untracked, the changes that have been made are untracked. It implies that when we go into a particular project area and we use the Git status, it lists out all the files representing that these changes have been made, but it has been tracked. It hasn't been tracked. So that implies that the changes were being made by the developer, but they were not added to the staging areas. So all the different statuses, like when post adding, before adding, and all those things, it keeps us a track of, so that we can see, okay, these are the changes we have made, but we haven't committed yet. So this is very useful for our understanding the changes that we have made and we forgot to commit. So that is useful coming. And then while synchronizing the repositories, we have add, origin, push and pull. And while we are working with parallel development, as I told, when we are working in collaboration, we have Git branch, Git merge and Git rebase, as we have discussed earlier. And then as I already told, what does the Git status does? It tells you which files are added to the index and which are ready to commit. And git add command tells like these files are added to the index, and git commit is useful for committing the changes from our working directory, sorry, staging environment, to our local repository. So now let's see how to work with user guides. So basically, if you don't have any idea on Git, so what basically we do, it's like we'll be installing the Git bash. This comes up while we are installing the Git desktop. You can check Git bash along with the installation process, so that Git bash gets installed in our local machine. So let's see how to get help from Git bash on the commands. So open the Git bash and type git hello. So it lists out all the commands. But in very brief, it will be explaining all the commands. So you can see clearly, like when we are starting the working area, we have two commands, that is clone and init. So if you want to create an empty repository, then we use the init command, initialize the repository that we are saying. And if you wanted to clone, if you wanted to get a copy of the existing repository, existing project from the centralized repository, we use git clone command. And working on the changes, I mean modifying any files, we have add, move, reset. Once we added, if we wanted to change the changes, then we'll do git reset command, hard reset or soft reset. And then while working with the history, we have log, we have show, status, etc. See what are the changes that are committed, what is the commit ID, what is the before commit that we have made. To track all these changes, we use the log command. And then when we are collaborating and when we are working, then we have branch checkout. Branch is usually used for listing of the branches and creating the branches or deleting the branches. And as I already told, it's useful when we are working on a collaboration, on a project, collaborating from with users from different environments or different regions, and then they are working, going to work on different user stories or bug fixes, and then they wanted to work individually, and then finally they wanted to commit the changes to the next branch. So check out. So initially I was working on a master branch issue, and then I wanted to switch on some necessary changes, so I needed fix need to be done, and I need to work on that and leave my work in off day. So what I'll be doing is, like, I'll be creating a new branch, and then I'll be start working with that branch by using the checkout. We'll be checking out to that branch. So what is the command that is used is like a git checkout hyphen d and the branch name. And as you already see in the commit, used for changing, I mean committing the changes to the particular branch. And then dip is very useful command to understand what is the difference made between two different working trees or two different changes in the file. And git merge, as I already explained, git merge is used for joining the core changes which have been made from one branch into another branch, like branch P1 to the master branch. Once we have done with all the changes in the branch P1, and everyone have been tested, and we feel it was it have been reviewed, and if we feel that it's working fine, so what we'll be doing is we'll be merging the branch to the master branch. And then tag is like just to maintain so like a version, like this line in the version, this is a particular version 1.0, version 2.0. so to revert back to some changes at a prior point in time, tags will be really very much useful. And then to fetch things from the remote repository, we'll be using the fetch, pull, and push commands. So this is at a very high level. So the guide is basically divided into some parts. So let's see how the guide is particularly divided here. So we can see git help I can see. So you can see if you wanted to go in deep the git, the guide has been divided into like this. Git commands for everyday users, git philosophy, git ignore, git modules, git results, git tutorial, git workflows, and git attributes. This is how it was divided. So if you want to have help on any one of these, how do we go to those things? So this let's look at tag git help tutorial. So what happens, it will be opening the tutorial file in your browser. So let's see in here, you can see that git tutorial has been opened, and you can just walk through whatever you wanted from this. You can get all the information in here. So this is the git tutorial session. So if you wanted to get some other help, like on a particular command, I wanted to know some information on log. Git help. Git log help. Okay. So git help log. So you have everything in brief about the log command, what are the various options which you will be having, and everything in detail. And then as we have discussed everything, and then so the git icons, as we are discussing, so git icons are like it's an indication that what is the status when we are working with Eclipse. We wanted to understand what is the current status of the file in my current project which I am working on. So assume I have different projects over here which I have already been working on. They are in different states. So like assume this project is having all the changes that have been tracked with the cylindrical icon representing that these changes have been tracked and it was in sync with my repository. And in here we can see the red plus icon. It indicates that there are some conflicts while merging. And in here we can see there are some question marks. So we can see here the symbolic question marks over here that represents these changes have been done but hadn't been tracked. So this repair changes have been done but haven't been tracked. So let's see what all other icons we have. So plus icon represents that some untracked changes have been added to the index. So these changes are now being tracked into the index. So that is what the plus icon indicates. So initially we have if we have cloned any project from the remote repository to local repository, and then we checked out the project into our working workspace, then it will be very much clearer. It will not be like it will be having a cylindrical icon to prevent it within using sync. So once we have done some changes, and then we haven't committed it, and we haven't added it to the changing area using the index, so it will be displayed with a question mark so that it represents that these changes haven't been tracked. These changes have been done and haven't been committed. So after that, once we use the git add command, so what happens is like the untracked changes will be moved to the saving area. So these are being listed in the saving area so that we can check out, we can list, we can verify all the changes we have made, and then we can start committing one by one or all at a time. So if you wanted to use the git command for verifying all the untracked changes, we can use git status. Navigating to that particular project directory, if you type the git status, you can see all the untracked changes, all the files with untracked changes listed over there. And like as we already told, the changes are indexed for tracking. And the cylindrical icon represents that these changes have been committed and it was in sync with our local repository. And star indicates the exchange changes. So these are all the basic icons. And one more icon, as we have seen only, it's a red icon indicating that there was some conflicts when we are doing a merge. So we can overcome the conflicts by going to the particular file. Once there is a conflict, Git will be adding some predefined lines to identify exactly where the issue was there. I mean, not an issue, but there was some changes. There was some lines of code which was saved on branch 1 and branch 2 while we are merging. So which line of code we wanted to maintain and which line of code we wanted to remove it. So once we have overcome this conflict, we can just merge it back. So the merge will be successful once we have changed this conflict. So let's do a quick recap on all the commands. So as we are saying, like git init is used to create a new repository, empty repository, and git log is used to see what happened, what are the commit rate changes. It's like a history. And git checkout and git branch are used for switching branches. And git add is to manage the index file. Git difference and git status to see what you are in the middle of something while we are doing. And git commit is to advance to the current branch, advance the current branch. And git reset and git checkout with passing parameters will undo the changes. Git merge is used for merging the local branches. Git rebase is the concept of merge, similar kind of merge, but it does a bit variant from the merge. And git tag is usually maintained to track back the changes in time. Like if there are two different clients, if you're working, if you wanted to track the changes, what you have been done for this particular client, and you have been doing some of the changes for some different client, you can track that by using a tag name. You can maintain the tag name as your client name, followed by the version number to identify the changes that have been made at that point of time. And git clone is used to get the copy of the remote repository from the upstream to the downstream. And git pull and git fetch from origin to keep up to date with the upstream. Git push is used to push the changes from our local to the shared repository. And that's it. And if you wanted to clone the repository or work with SSH, then we need to do some configurations in GitHub. So there will be a personal settings area. In the settings area, we need to configure. I mean, we need to go to SSH and GPS keys and generate the key, and then we can start working with SSH. And then we need to add the username which we want to connect, and the key we need to create using here. So this is all we'll be learning related to the practical questions. So this is all the theoretical concepts for GIT. Thank you.